August 1942. A young woman boards a train in Vienna, bound for Munich, a city celebrating one Nazi victory after another. She carries a suitcase, a book of poetry, and nothing else. Her papers say she is 20-year-old Greta Denner, a full-blooded Aryan who can travel freely in the Reich. But she is not who she says she is. Sewn into the spine of the book are her true identity papers. She is, in fact, Edith Hahn, a Jewish fugitive wanted by the Gestapo.
I had to forget what I have learned. I didn't want to have any questions about myself, about my education, about my life, or anything.
On that train to Munich, Edith Hahn willed herself to disappear. Now, as Greta Denner, she sped toward an uncertain future in the heart of Hitler's Reich. She could not imagine the life she would lead, the role she would have to play, the woman she would become.
I have the feeling I had a wonderful youth. I have the feeling that I had everything and I didn't lack anything and I was very, very happy.
Edith was born in Vienna on January 24, 1914, on the eve of the First World War. Her father, Leopold, went off to fight with the Austro-Hungarian army. When he returned home, the city he knew as a boy was no longer the seat of empire. He and his wife, Clotilde, set out to build a life together with their three daughters, Edith, Mimi, Hansi. These were the Hahns of Vienna.
My father had a restaurant in the first district of Vienna, and it was very, very nice. So we loved being there. And we were told that Austria is the nicest country, has the best food, the best fashion, and is everything on top of the world. This was what we were told.
Leopold's restaurant wasn't kosher. The Hahns lived in an integrated neighborhood. They rarely went to synagogue. Yet, like many assimilated Jews of Vienna, religion still set them apart.
I had never the feeling of anti-Semitism or something. But in the school, in my school, I do remember still that I was always asked what language we are speaking at home. My parents couldn't speak any other language than German. This teacher, I suppose, wanted to know if we are talking Polish at home or Yiddish, but I didn't understand it at that time. Now I know. Now I know what it meant.
He had all the burdens of being Jewish in an anti-Semitic country, but none of the strengths, the Torah learning, the prayers, the worldwide community. We spoke no Yiddish or Hebrew. We had no deep faith in God. We were not Polish Hasidim or Lithuanian yeshiva scholars. What we mostly had was intellect and style.
Austria's economy suffered after the war. In 1928, Leopold's restaurant became a casualty of the spiraling inflation, but the Hahns managed to scrape by. Edith, the oldest daughter, was the intellectual of the family, but she had to convince her father to let her go to high school. It was never a given for Edith or her sisters. He finally said yes.
It opened up a new world. Different books, different friends, different interests. I was very interested in philosophy. And at the age of 17, I gave a talk about Nietzsche in our class. And I don't know if I have really understood it at that time, but I did give a talk.
For the first time, I began to have friends with whom I could really talk about the things I cared about. History, literature, society's many ills, and how to cure them completely so that everyone would be happy.
Edith was a very happy and intelligent person, and was especially popular in our class.
Hans Vesely was a Christian classmate of Edith's. In a class of 36 students, Edith was one of only three Jews.
She was especially helpful and sociable, not like most people. And so, like her, there was no splitting and no tension between Jews and the others. There were no political tensions. The class was a peaceful class.
One in our class, his name, we called him Nazi, he became a high SS man in later on. But at that time, this was when I was at high school, the Nazi Party was forbidden in Austria. When I was studying, I left my study and wasn't interested in the Nazis.
The Nazi Party had its roots in Germany and was guided by the emerging leadership of Adolf Hitler, who desired a unified Germany and Austria. This was opposed by Austria's own nationalist government and by the Socialist Party, the ruling political party in Vienna.
In Vienna, two-thirds of the population was socialist, two-thirds. It attracted me. Socialism attracted me. I loved to go to that meetings, and we had lectures and dances and everything, but outings, and I liked it.
For 17-year-old Edith, the Socialist Club was the center of her world. There, she met Pepe Rosenfeld. He was a year ahead of her in school, sophisticated, an intellectual leader, and in Edith, he found his equal.
Once, I had to go to the National Library, and I have never been to the National Library in Vienna. And he told me he would show me the ropes. But we didn't go to the library. We went to the Belvedere. The Belvedere is a lovely park nearby. And there he kissed me. And later on he was so impressed, he photographed the bench where we were sitting.
Pepe, born Josef Rosenfeld, was the son of a Jewish father and a Catholic mother. He pursued Edith with a passion she had never known before.
Pepe could always get my attention. I'd be in class, in a bookstore, in a cafe, and suddenly I would feel a tingling at the nape of my neck. I'd turn around and there he would be, staring at me. He never talked nonsense. He always had a point to make. I felt that my long search for someone to share my passion for ideas and books and art had finally ended. Soon I was madly in love with him and could think of no one else.
For me, he was the one who knew everything, and I admired him. I could talk to him, and I could talk about everything.
They talked about politics and socialism, of saving the world. Edith wanted to study law. They both enrolled at the University of Vienna.
I wanted to be an advocate or a judge. I wanted to fight for what was right. I wanted to fight for justice.
In 1933, Hitler was sworn in as the new Chancellor of Germany, and ultimately given dictatorial powers by the German parliament.
We were students, and we didn't talk so much about it, because Germany with Hitler was so far away, it was on another planet.
What about Adolf Hitler? Pepe asked. Oh, him. He's not a thinker, he's just a ranter and a raver. There may come a time, said Pepe, when people cannot tell the difference.
Well, you know, at that time, we didn't know what Nazism really means. I mean, that it, all the terrible things all happened later, you see.
Kurt Rothschild was a classmate of Edith's, also studying law.
I knew her only for a rather short time. She was a good-humored girl. She liked to laugh, yes. She could dance better than I, but that doesn't mean very much. She was certainly assimilated, just like me. I mean, the Jewishness didn't play any role at that time. Within your circle of friends, it didn't matter. I mean, in school, it didn't matter.
Even in this protected world of books and ideas, it was impossible to ignore the political turmoil that was consuming Austria. In 1934, over a third of the Viennese workforce was unemployed. Socialist strikers squared off against the army, and hundreds were killed. In July of that year, the nation's chancellor was assassinated by Austrian Nazis trying to topple the government. Martial law was imposed. But for Edith, the most difficult news of all came much closer to home.
My father died suddenly on the 3rd of June, 1936. He was a baby at that time. We got a telegram that he's ill at first, but he was already dead. He had died of a heart attack.
Pepe stroked my hair and told me that everything would be all right. I didn't believe him. I felt suddenly much more vulnerable to politics than ever before. How could we withstand these tumultuous times without our father to protect us? At the Munich Olympics that summer, the German athletes saluted their ugly little Führer, and every victory of theirs felt to me like a personal attack against the Hans of Vienna.
Now 30,000 carrier figures are released. There are the dozens of teams symbolizing the comradeship that exists among all nations in the athletic arena.
After her father's death, Edith had to help support the family. She began tutoring the Denner girls who lived in a neighboring apartment. Their mother had died of tuberculosis.
He was never there, the father. You can imagine that the girls came with everything to me. So I came to be like the elder sister, and it was a very intimate relationship. I was at that time 22. I was at the university. Crystal, she was 8 years younger. I was 14.
Crystal came to Edith with all her teenage dramas, the boys and their crushes. They could share each other's secrets. But neither could know how important those secrets would become. Of March 12th, 1938, what had seemed so far away could no longer be ignored. The German army crossed the Austrian border unopposed.
They came on the Sunday and marched into Austria. It was the end of an epoch.
When it came, it was a shock, of course. On the last day, before they came in, it was already clear that there is a danger, and we demonstrated in the streets against the Nazis.
This was on the 11th of March. On the 13th of March, there would have been a referendum, a vote to decide whether we wanted Austria to join with Germany or to remain independent. And there were our police, still in their Austrian uniforms, all standing along the Ringstrasse. But all of them already had swastikas on their arms.
Dagmar Ostermann also grew up in Vienna. She was 17 years old when the Nazis arrived.
And from this moment on, we were not Austria anymore. We were the Ostmark. There was a man standing there, a bit heavy but not very tall, in civilian clothes with a swastika on his arm. And he was beating up a guy with dark eyes and black hair. And he was shouting "Jewish swine" over and over again. And the other man was fighting back and was saying, "I'm not even a Jew." If you looked a bit different, that was enough to be slapped in the face on the streets.
At once, it started. The Jews were taken to prison. My uncle, my mother's brother, was arrested.
In the beginning, it was terrible for the Jews. They were dragged into the streets, and they made them scrub the pavement.
In Germany, the things developed much more slowly. In Austria, the things happened much quicker. After a few weeks, most of us realized that we can't continue to live in this country.
After the Nazi came, everyone wanted to leave Vienna. Everyone. There were long queues at all embassies. But Pepe, he took me in his arms and said we will stay, come through that together.
I am here with you. I love you. You are mine. I will always take care of you. He kissed me with such passion that I felt my whole body grow warm and light. What did I care if politicians disappeared and nations prepared for war? I had Pepe, my genius, my comfort.
I was sure that it will not be long, that it will soon be over. But it started so suddenly. Every day you heard about arrests and sending away. Jewish children couldn't go to school anymore. There are a Jewish shop. You shouldn't go into a Jewish shop. Everybody was terribly afraid.
Edith and Pepe's best hope of a future together seemed to be in crossing the border out of Austria.
Many got married just to go away together, who were not thinking of marriage before, but they got married to go away together. But Pepe didn't want to do anything, because his mother said when he goes away, she would jump from the balcony and she would commit suicide. She was a very domineering person. He didn't want even to talk about it. But he was in love with me.
That was the only reason I stayed in Austria, you see. I was in love. And I couldn't imagine life without my Pepe.
But the life they had imagined for themselves was slipping away.
Well, it changed pretty rapidly. Jews were thrown out of the universities right away. That happened immediately. The policy was to say, these are German universities and Jews are not that permitted to study in German universities.
I had my last exam at the university and I have worked half a year for it, sometimes 8 hours a day. And now, as I went to the university, they said, I'm sorry, you don't get it. I expected to get my doctorate after that exam. And this was all gone now.
How can I describe to you our confusion and terror when the Nazis took over? We had lived until yesterday in a rational world. Now everyone around us are our schoolmates, neighbors and teachers, our tradesmen, policemen and bureaucrats had all gone mad. They had been harboring a hatred for us, which we had grown accustomed to calling prejudice. What a gentle word that was. What a euphemism.
The Nuremberg laws, which had stripped Jews of their rights in Germany, were now imposed with a vengeance in Austria. Life grew more and more impossible. Edith's two sisters escaped to Palestine. The family said their goodbyes at the train station. They took only what they could carry: bread for the journey, some hard-boiled eggs, a change of clothes.
We hoped that we see each other again. My mother was crying, but she was very happy to, you know it, at that time, you were glad when the children were out of the country safe.
On the way home from the station, an orange glow lit up the night sky. Edith pulled at her mother and started to run. Vienna, their Vienna, was burning.
They went into the Jewish houses, and they robbed the shops, and they broke all the windows and everything.
Crystal knocked, the night of broken glass, November 9th, 1938. A reign of terror exploded on the streets throughout Austria and Germany. Nazi thugs torched Jewish shops and synagogues. Thousands of Jews were rounded up.
A cousin of mine, he passed a synagogue and saw the burning synagogue. And he didn't go anymore home and came to us. And so he survived.
Pepe arrived at Edith's apartment, safe as well.
He couldn't stand to see me upset. He rubbed the worry from my forehead. At that moment, I adored Pepe Rosenfeld. I felt as though his good nature, his fearlessness, would ultimately lead us all out of this inferno. And then his mother Anna arrived, screaming. "Are you an idiot?" she bellowed at him. "I bribed half the officials in the city to make you a Christian and get you off the list of the Jewish community. And now, tonight, what do? You come right into their hiding place and sit in their parlor. Get away from these people. These are not your people. These people are foreigners. Everybody hates them."
She wanted at first that we should get engaged at the beginning. But after the Nazi came, she wanted to separate him from me. She wanted him safe.
In his eyes, I finally saw what he had been putting up with all these weeks since the Nazis arrived. Why he had never quite agreed to leave. "Go," I said softly. "Go home with her. Go." He did. And the rest of us sat up together for all the rest of Kristallnacht, listening to the sound of our lives shattering.
Edith and her mother were evicted from their home and forced to move to the Viennese ghetto, where they lived in a room with five people in an apartment meant for one.
I felt very close to my mother and had the feeling that it is my duty to look after her.
All across the Reich, Jewish businesses were shut down or seized by the Nazis. The lives people had built over generations were now up for the taking by their former neighbors.
They were blind followers. They were coming from everywhere and trying to be part of this. They were now saying, "I can inherit something. I can get a shop. I can get this and that. I can plunder a flat." It actually developed into this accepted form. It is unbelievable, isn't it?
It was more or less a way to get something cheap. They all did it.
And
why were these people like this? Please. I mean, that's how it is. When there's a pack of wolves, you howl with the wolves.
The Jews of Vienna, those that remained, were now stranded, trapped in a shadow world no longer their own.
There was no way out anymore. I waited for the end. I was always thinking, in 2 months it is over. I was walking down with Pepe, and somebody in the street said that Paris had fallen. And I felt sick. I had to go home. I was definitely bodily sick. Because of the shock. The therapist took me and was holding me so that I would not be noticed by others. But I was hoping and living on that. Germany would lose.
In the spring of 1941, Edith and her mother, Clotilda, were forced to report to the city's registration office. The Nazis started with every Jewish citizen whose last name began with A and worked their way through the alphabet until all the remaining Jews of Vienna were accounted for.
Everything was done as difficult and cruel as possible. They ordered all the Jews for 9 o'clock in the morning. We were in a long, long queue. Many of the old people, they fainted. But this didn't matter to them. They fainted.
Edith and Clotilda never reached the registration office. They were pulled from the line to be sent to the north of Germany. Agricultural work, the Gestapo called it. Edith's legal training came rushing back. She argued with all the strength of a courtroom lawyer, convincing the Nazis that her mother was too old to be sent. But Edith herself was not spared.
If I didn't show up at the train station tomorrow, the paper said, I would be treated as a wanted criminal and hunted down without mercy. 6 weeks, I said, that's all. 6 weeks and I will be home. Mama packed nearly all the food in the house for me. As the train whistle blew, I whispered to Mama that she shouldn't be sad, that I would see her in 6 weeks.
To go away from my mother was hard for me. We were very close, and I hoped that it was for 6 weeks. It worked out to be 13 months. This was the last time I saw my mother. It was a long journey, a long train, and we didn't know where we were going. I have never left Austria before. It was the first time that I left Austria. I looked out of the window. It was a very desolate landscape.
Vienna, Leipzig, Magdeburg, Stendal, all the way to Osterburg, a farming community 125 miles west of Berlin. Edith was forced to work in the fields as a slave laborer through blistering sun and driving rain from 4 a.m. until day's end. She imagined it would have been better to die quickly in Vienna than by inches in this mud. To make sense of what was going on around her, to keep her sanity, Edith took pictures with a little box camera that her father had given her. She also turned out letters by the hundreds.
I wrote to Peppy, sometimes twice a day. Altogether, I wrote about 250 letters in 13 months. I talked to him about the everyday life. I talked about my companions and about everyday life. It was new to him and new to me. But this is what it is to be in love. This morning I have sung so much about love, lots of silly songs, and the man I love is so far away. You are far away. Your lips are far away, in which I want to press myself. When will I feel
you again? How long will this terrible fate hold us apart? My dear young boy, now I know how wonderful it would have been if we had gone together to England to start a new life, a new experience. Everything now is different. It is another day behind me, and I am happy about that. Every day which has passed brings me closer to you. When will we be able to win back these lost days,
weeks,
and months?
We have just heard that there is war with America. I hope that the high point is reached as a result of that, and at least we are coming towards the end of this war. But this is not yet. This is...
Edith's time as a forced laborer stretched from 6 weeks to more than a year. She watched as her best friend from the fields, Mina Katz, was ordered back to Vienna to be deported to Poland with her family. In her darkest days, Edith told Pepe to burn all her letters. The words they shared, Edith's wish that the Nazis would all be destroyed, rumors of the so-called resettlement camps, were now too dangerous. And then the worst news of all arrived. Edith's mother was on the deportation list in Vienna. She wanted Edith to come home so they could be sent away together as a family. Clotilda clung to the hope that in Poland, at a resettlement camp, they could rebuild their lives.
She hopes that somewhere there will be a place where we can live a normal life. Once Pepe wrote to me that she was thinking of taking her sewing machine with her, as she didn't know about Auschwitz or anything. Of course, nobody expected anything good, but she thought if she may earn some money by doing some sewing.
When Edith was finally sent back to Vienna, it was too late.
She was sent away on the 9th of June, and I came on the 22nd to Vienna. I couldn't get any news. She was gone. And this was the last letter my mother wrote. It is 12:30 at night. She wrote to Pepe, "We are waiting for the SS. You can imagine what I feel like. Please, please help Edith do the packing, because she expected me to come too. Please look after my last few things that I have left. There is a suitcase to be collected. It is full of things Edith will have to take with her. May you stay well. May we meet again and help in health and happiness. Oh, my dear Pepe, I am so sad. I want to live. Please don't forget us. Kisses, Sasha." She was gone, and I had not a minute the feeling that I could find my mother anywhere in Poland. I never had the feeling.
Realizing it would be impossible to find her mother, Edith only had two options: to report to the Gestapo as told, or go underground. Edith chose to remove the yellow star that Jews were now forced to wear, becoming a fugitive in her own city. She was risking her own life by doing this. She was also now a risk to others.
I had come back to Vienna, sure in my heart that when Pepe saw me, he would want me again, and we would live in hiding in this city for the rest of the war. But it was a vain and stupid hope. Petty said, "You don't understand what it could mean to be involved with a person like you, who was wanted by the Gestapo." The focus of my life had been my love affair with Pepe Rosenfeld, and the Nazis had destroyed that. They had made him afraid of me.
I felt betrayed. Betrayed. And forsaken. Abandoned. And this is why I made up my mind. This was my reaction. Whatever happens, never to marry him. And then I had nowhere to stay. I went to parks. Was a risk for me was to go in the street, because at first I didn't wear the star, and the second I was wanted by the Gestapo. This was a horrible time.
Edith stayed away from her old neighborhood, afraid someone might denounce her. She was hungry and desperate in her own city. She reached out to her friend Crystal Denner. They were still close, like sisters, but there was little Crystal could do for her. Rejected by Pepe, most of her family gone, Edith could think of nowhere to go, except to the enemy. A Nazi party member by the name of Maria Niederall. Mina Katz, Edith's best friend from the fields of Osterberg, had told her about Maria Niederall. She had once helped Mina and her friends. But could Edith trust her? How could she trust any Nazi?
Well, she was a stranger to me. I went to her just to ask if she has any news of me, of Mina.
She wore real gold earrings, and on her bosom a special swastika honor badge to show that she had joined the Nazi party early in the 1930s. I was hoping you would have heard from Mina. Nothing, Maria said. Suddenly, her eyes glistened with tears. She shook them away. I could have helped her, you know. She could have stayed in Austria. She wanted to be with her family, I explained. If I could have been with Mama, I would have gone as well.
After 6 weeks in hiding, Edith could not go on. She was ready to surrender to the Gestapo. But Maria wouldn't let this happen. She told her to go to an address in the 4th District. There was a man who could help her there.
And she had told me to tell him the truth.
I went right away, with no more conversation. The sign on the door said Office of Racial Affairs. In the Reich, citizens had to prove they had been Aryan for 3 generations. That was where Maria Niederall had sent me. I thought, my God, I've been betrayed. When I saw the man in the office, my heart contracted in my chest.
He was in SS uniform, in brown uniform. I had the feeling he's double my size and had a big swastika on the sleeve. But I wasn't frightened because I trusted her. I trusted Maria Niederall 100%, and I told him the truth. And he at once told me what to do.
The river will keep your secret safe, he said. Is there an Aryan friend you can trust with your life? Because you'll be asking the same of her. The plan was simple, straightforward, but very dangerous to carry out. First, the friend would have to concoct a story for the police, saying she lost all her identity papers in the Danube. If the police believed her, if the lie worked, duplicates would be issued. Edith would carry the originals, taking on her friend's identity, but in name only. She would have to get out of Vienna immediately. There could not be two people with the same name, the same identity papers, in the same city. The risk of being caught was just too great.
The man turned away. The meeting was over. I had never listened so hard to anything in my life. Every word was printed on my mind. He did not wish me luck. He did not ask for money. He did not say goodbye. I never saw him again. He saved my life.
There was only one person Edith could possibly turn to. Crystal Denner.
I rang up Crystal. We met in some cafe, and Crystal was at once ready to do it. She took a risk of her life. She risked her life.
Crystal took her story to the police on July 30th, 1942, saying she lost all of her papers in a boating accident on the Danube. The police believed her. Edith now carried her friend's original identity papers. She knew she had to flee the city, but she did not know where to go.
And it's the pictures. I went to the pictures again. And in the pictures, I saw a news again. But that time, it was a news about the House of German Art. In Munich. I had the feeling that one of these statues she showed was talking to me. The statue was called Die Woge, the wave.
I heard the voice of the wave calling like my mother's voice, and in it I heard love, security, kindness, blessing. It was a fantasy, of course, but it happened. It happened to me in my time of greatest fear and confusion, when I was about to unbecome myself.
The statue told me to come, and so I decided to go to Munich.
Edith took the suitcase her mother had left for her, packed with 6 handmade dresses and little else. Pepe joined her at the train station. He had one last gift, a book of poetry.
Pepe had in a book, he put in the cover, on one side, my exam paper of the main exam, and on the other side, in the back side, my identity card, who I am. This he had given to me and had made for me.
"Someday maybe you will need these," he whispered, "to show someone what a brilliant law student you were in your previous life." He didn't kiss me goodbye. The time for kisses was over.
To the world, Edith was now 20-year-old Crystal Margareta Denner. She could not for a moment forget that.
I was Margareta Denner, so I called myself Great Denner. My story was very simple. My mother died, and my father got married again to a woman not much older than I am, and I couldn't get on with her. And this is why I left, and I wanted to join the Red Cross. It was a very plausible story, and I always told the same story. And I had to pretend to be 8 years younger. I had always to be very, very careful when I talked about it, not to give me away.
Edith became what was known as a U-boat, her true identity hidden from the world, a fugitive hiding in plain sight in Nazi Germany.
A U-boat is a boat that isn't seen, what lives under the water. And I had to live underneath. Yes, I was a young wolf.
Edith arrived in Munich, the birthplace of the Nazi Party. As Greta, she did what she could to blend in. She was able to find work with the Red Cross as an unskilled nurse's aide. In Vienna, the man at the Office of Racial Affairs had told her that women across the Reich would soon be asked to register for work to support the war effort. Only in the Red Cross could she avoid putting her name on the National Registry. Each morning, Edith was trained how to change bandages and dressings, the basics of anatomy. Each afternoon, she was taught by members of the Frauenschaft, the woman's auxiliary of the Nazi Party.
There was a group of young girls who were training, and they told us, we are responsible for the spirit of the soldiers. We have to tell the soldiers that it is not so bad. And they told us that we, the Red Cross nurses, are the nearest to Hitler's heart. You know how I felt. I can imagine. The nearest to Hitler's heart.
Remember, said our Nazi tutor, he loves you and you must return his love without reservation. She made us swear a special oath to the Führer. We raised our arms, we said, Heil Hitler. Deep down I prayed, let the beast Hitler be destroyed. Let the Americans and the RAF bomb the Nazis to dust. Let the German army freeze at Stalingrad. Let me not be forgotten here. Let someone remember who I really am.
In Munich, the Germans celebrated, flush with victory. It seemed they couldn't be stopped. North Africa, France, the Eastern Front. Edith would pass her days in this world turned upside down.
Every time some soldiers invited me to cafe and cake. There were everywhere soldiers, and usually the soldiers wanted to meet me again. I made a date, and I didn't keep the dates. I couldn't.
That summer of 1942, Edith walked through parks, busy streets, visited the art galleries where she could lose herself in the crowds.
I went to a picture gallery. This was called the Maximilianeum. And I went to the Maximilianeum, I went through it, and sat down. And then a young man took the chair beside me and started to talk to me. He didn't know a lot about painting. He was not a soldier. He was on holiday from Brandenburg in Munich. And he was Werner Vetter.
Werner Vetter was tall, blonde, the image of an Aryan. And although he was not a soldier, he wore a swastika pin in his lapel, a privilege reserved for members of the Nazi Party. Edith, against all logic, trusted him. She broke a basic rule of hers. Never see anyone more than once.
That time, I don't know why, but I met him again. All these 7 days, we met.
When I think of the risk I took, he could have been anyone. I am astounded even now. But I liked Werner, you see. He was easygoing and entertaining. He loved to talk, so I didn't have to say much. During that week with Werner, I learned what I needed to know to successfully pretend to be one of them. It was Greta's training period. And then, of course, there was the fact that he made me feel like a woman again. The way he held the doors open for me and handed me up the train steps every evening. It was a strange, surreal feeling.
Werner was exempt from military service. A motorcycle accident had left him blind in one eye. He saw himself as an artist. The reality was, he managed the paint department at a factory which turned out warplanes for the German Luftwaffe. They were together only a week. Werner went home to Brandenburg, over 400 miles away. They wrote to each other, the nurse's aide and the factory manager. Edith sent Werner a cake on his birthday. They kept alive their wartime romance. She never let slip who she really was. 2 months after they met, Edith received a telegram. Werner was coming back to Munich. He had to see her.
It was very early in the morning. We went to a cafe, have a coffee. And the first thing what he said to me was a proposal of marriage. I was shocked. I was really devastated. I was really in desperation how to get out of it.
"You," I cried, "I can't be involved with you." "Why not?" "My God, Greta, how can this be?" He looked hurt, destroyed by the idea that I might not want him. I recognized his pain because I had felt it myself. I threw my arms around him and whispered violently into his ear.
In the end, I told him the truth. And I like to tell the truth.
Edith thought of her family, her sisters in Palestine, her mother's fate. Telling Werner that she was Jewish, the truth about her false papers, was a monumental risk. But to Werner, the truth didn't seem to matter. He had secrets of his own.
He confessed to me that he was not telling me the truth in the summer about himself, and confessed to me that he is married and is in divorce proceedings. And he confessed to me. He told me lies and I told him lies. He stuck to his proposal and wanted to marry me.
Edith didn't say yes that day. She told him to go back to Brandenburg, to forget about all they had shared. But Werner had made up his mind.
In the end, I thought he loves me. And so I came to Brandenburg.
In January, after his divorce came through, we lived in Werner's flat as an engaged couple. When he closed the door behind us, I became a privileged middle-class German woman. I had a home, a safe place, a protector. I felt very lucky.
This was quite a different atmosphere I came into it. I didn't know what I have to do to survive. I did every day what was necessary at that time, because I had to fit into this life.
In the industrial town of Brandenburg, surrounded by Nazis, Edith would have to bury her past, even with Werner.
We enjoyed a very quiet, peaceful relationship, Werner and I. But you must understand that I was not the old Edith, full of demands and opinions. I was concerned only that everything should be as Werner liked it. I never deliberately reminded him that I was Jewish. I only wanted him to forget that, to put that fact away in the back of his mind, as I had put away Edith Hahn, and just let it gather dust there, barely remembered.
Edith had once dreamt of a life with Pepe, but now that was over.
I told Pepe I'm engaged. Oh, then I got letters. He told me then I should think of my mother. Before he didn't think of my mother. On the one hand, I was jilted by Pepe. Né? On the other hand, a man who did know me 7 days and had such a devotion to me. Man, this opposite. I had finished with Pepe.
Not yet married, but living together, Edith nonetheless had to play the role of a traditional German housewife.
At the end of the day, I stood at the stove and waited for Werner to come home. I knew he often peeked through the keyhole, just because it pleased him so much to see me cooking his dinner. I pretended to be so engrossed that I did not notice him entering, and he came up behind me and lifted me away from the stove, the stirring spoon still in my hand.
He was very particular about the household, and I was always ready with the cooking. I wanted to do my job properly, as I at any job I did. I wanted to do it properly, and I did. He was in a way attentive to me too. In the evening when he came home, so we read books together and we played chess. I didn't come to him with things I didn't know he is not interested in it or is outside his life experience. But with his first wife, he was quarreling a lot and he wanted somebody to talk to.
At home, there was one thing that Edith never spoke of. The emptiness that was all around her. What had happened to the Jews of Brandenburg, of Germany, of Austria? What had become of her mother?
Nobody talked about the Jews. They didn't exist, they were gone. With Werner, I didn't talk about these things because I didn't want him to share the Jewish anxieties. He hoped that I will live as an Aryan in the victorious Germany with him. This, so he thought. Of course, he believed that Germany will be victorious. All the Nazis, all Germany believed that Germany will be victorious.
The truth was, by February 1943, Germany was at a turning point in the war. The reports from abroad told a much different story than the official Nazi propaganda.
He had, when I lived in his flat, he had a very good radio. But the radio was set so that you could hear only Germany. Because it was forbidden to hear radio from abroad. This was a crime. But when I was there, very soon, I got him to listen with me to the foreign radio. I don't know anymore how it started, but for him it was a different world, what he heard.
Men of the Red Army finishing off the would-be conquerors of Stalingrad, finally crushing every point of resistance.
Using a blanket to muffle the sound, I heard for the first time the true extent of the German defeat at the Battle of Stalingrad. More than 140,000 had been slaughtered, 91,000 taken prisoner. Tears rolled down Werner's face. From that time on, I listened to the foreign radio 3 or 4 times a day. And Werner listened too.
Hitler's seemingly invincible army had suffered its first massive defeat. Edith was buoyed by the news. But in Brandenburg, the Nazis were still very much in control. In the local hospital, Edith looked after the foreign patients, many of them injured workers who had fed the German war machine.
I spoke French to the Frenchman, and a nurse asked me once I should say to the Frenchman, all Frenchmen are pigs. But I said I don't know the French word for pigs. I wouldn't say such a thing to the Frenchman. And somebody denounced me and said I'm too friendly to the foreigners. And then it was forbidden for me to work with foreigners. I should only work with Germans. And so I came to the maternity ward. And this was a joy.
Here, Germany's future was welcomed, kicking and crying into the world. Now surrounded by a sea of children, Edith started to imagine the impossible, having her own baby, raising a family in Hitler's Reich. Edith was afraid that she was losing her grip on who she was. Having a child meant she would never have to be alone. She told Werner she wanted a baby. To Werner, this threatened the very foundation of what had kept them together, Edith's ability to hide her true self.
But Werner didn't want it, no. Maybe then he was thinking of me being who I am. The baby would look Jewish and would behave Jewish, what he thinks. When he has heard such doctrines for nearly 10 years. But after a while, he agreed. It was not an accident. He agreed.
With the baby on the way, Werner now had one condition. Edith must become his legal wife.
When I was pregnant, it was he who wanted to get married, not me, because I didn't care. I wanted the child illegitimate. But he felt he was the pillar of society, of Nazi society, and has to get married. And I took the papers, I went to the register office, and I had still only this document, Crystal's papers, and I was afraid, really afraid.
To get a marriage license, Edith would have to prove that she was a pure Aryan, that her bloodline could be traced back to her grandparents. The lie she was living would have to survive one more test. The registrar was suspicious. Edith didn't have all the documents she needed. He looked at her through his thick glasses. He would pass judgment himself.
He looked for a time at me, and for me it was an eternity. And then he said, it is to see that I'm not Jewish. My face was my Aryan proof that I'm not Jewish.
On October 16th, 1943, Edith and Werner were married. She wore a dress made by her mother, carried in the suitcase all the way from Vienna.
I was terribly nervous. I was so afraid I may sign differently. I may sign my real name and everybody who got married got Mein Kampf as a present from the state. But they ran out just when I got married, and I'm still waiting for it.
In a matter of a little more than a year, I had gone from being the most despised creature in the Third Reich, a hunted Jewish slave girl dodging a transport to Poland, to being one of its most valued citizens, a breeding Aryan housewife. People treated me with concern and respect. If they only knew who I had been, if they only knew whose new life I was breeding.
Easter Sunday, 1944. The contractions came through the night as Allied planes droned overhead on their way to Berlin. Edith's fear of discovery outweighed the pain of childbirth. She refused anesthesia, terrified that under sedation, she would give herself away.
I didn't take anything. And I must say, this was the only moment where I wanted to die. She was born and she was over 3 kilos. She was a big baby. She's born quite naturally, like in the jungle.
Edith named the child Maria Angelica Vetter, for Maria Niederau, the Nazi who had helped save her life.
I'm a child of a perpetrator. I'm a child of a victim. I am the only Jewish child to have been born in a normal, ordinary Nazi hospital, welcomed by a room full of Nazi doctors, as another child for Hitler in 1944. My mother always wanted to. She loves children. And especially on this cutting edge of life that might end at any moment. I'm sure it kept her sane.
The Red Cross nurse's aide, the Nazi factory worker, and their young daughter returned home from the hospital. For a brief time, in her own way, Edith managed to recreate what had been lost to her, a family. Edith returned to her childhood home, Vienna, with Werner and the baby. The train journey back was nothing like her anonymous exit 2 years before. The Nazi soldiers now moved aside for this young mother and her child.
She was 5 months old. I never was treated so well. They made such a fuss with me. Nobody ever made such a fuss anymore. And in the morning, I went then to Frau Doktor, to Frau Niederall. And Frau Niederall, she was very friendly, and she laughed, and she was so pleased that the baby laughs.
Now Edith felt safe on the streets of Vienna, safe in her disguise, safe with Werner at her side.
He met in Vienna all the people and he loved everybody. He loved Frau Doktor. He met Peppy, and there was a relationship between them. And even he had Peppy. He helped him with his document.
By 1944, young men in the city were being looked at with great suspicion as possible deserters from Hitler's army. Peppy believed he was in danger of being arrested on the street at any moment. Using his artistic training, Werner forged a document that showed Peppy had a job indispensable to the war effort.
In my eyes, it was perfect. A magic document that would keep Peppy secure for the duration of the war. Even now I have to smile when I think of this. I tell you, of all the things about Werner Vetter that appealed to me, this most of all warmed my heart. He had no respect for the truth in Nazi Germany.
On September 1st, 1944, Werner was drafted. Blind in one eye, he was an unlikely soldier to serve in the army. But in a last-ditch effort to defend German cities from the advancing Allied forces, men who had been overlooked were now being called up. His military superior saw something special in Werner. He was given extra training. He was made a Nazi officer.
He didn't like the uniform, but he was a Nazi officer now.
My disguise had now reached the outer limits of absurdity, its most fantastic incarnation. I had become the best thing a German woman could be in that time and place, a Nazi officer's wife.
Werner was ordered east with his unit to fight a losing war. He passed thousands of Germans fleeing in the opposite direction. "Keep your fingers crossed for me," he wrote. As the Allies advanced into Nazi-held territory, a more complete picture of the horrors of the concentration camps began to emerge. Edith, alone in the apartment, listened to the foreign radio. She heard for the first time of the millions dead, the piles of human bones, the crematoriums.
I felt shocked and devastated. There were no Jews. I was the only one. Of course I thought of my mother.
I lay on the floor, unable to absorb the horror of what I'd just been told. Who can imagine a living, breathing, laughing mother as smoke and ashes? No one can imagine that. My mind shut down. I sank like a rock to the bottom of my soul. The true meaning of the term U-boat came clear to me in that moment. I felt myself buried alive, in silence, under an ocean of terror. I was living among accomplices.
But what about Werner? Was he an accomplice, like all the others? In Brandenburg, Edith didn't differentiate between good Nazis and bad Nazis. They were all capable of betraying her. Werner never threatened to denounce her. Even so, he believed in the Nazi ideology, and it colored everything about their life together.
Today, looking back, do you think he was an anti-Semite?
No, he was a Nazi, and the Nazis gave everybody conviction that they are something better than everybody else, they are something better, and I suppose he had the same feeling. He had this brush of the propaganda on him. But it was on anybody in the Nazi time. You couldn't help it.
My mother did see it in him. And I know for a fact that he was anti-Semitic, that he believed Hitler's Nuremberg laws. But she had to bury these thoughts. Otherwise, psychologically speaking, you go to pieces. You have a breakdown. And if you have a nervous breakdown in that situation, you've denounced yourself. You've exposed yourself.
Werner was captured by the Russians after his unit was attacked. He would be sent to a prison camp in Siberia,
A German officer came to me and told me that he's captured. I was glad. I had the feeling he's safe. He will come back when he was a prisoner of war, but I didn't know what would happen to him if he had to fight.
City after city in Germany began to fall. In April 1945, Brandenburg came under heavy fire. The siren lasted for an hour as the Russians broke through. Edith, her neighbors, Wehrmacht soldiers all fled west. In a small town on the outskirts of the city, Edith found shelter in a farmhouse.
They just didn't bomb the place where I was. You couldn't look for safety in that times. It was just luck. And listen to the last speech of Dönitz. Dönitz was the successor of Hitler. And I heard it. And he said that everybody should follow the orders of the Allies, and that it is lost everything.
Brandenburg was decimated. Edith pushed the baby carriage through blasted streets littered with corpses. At night, she hid herself away.
There was no water, no gas, no electricity, nothing. We had to go to a hydrant, far away, to fetch some water. And we had nothing to eat either. And with the baby. It was horrible.
There was no home for Edith to return to. Her apartment was in flames. Miraculously, in the wreckage, she found the suitcase her mother had packed for her years ago. Inside, the book of poems that Pepe had given her had survived. In the spine of the book were her exams from the university and her identity papers. This was all that mattered. Edith Hahn, the paper said. But even though the war was over, Edith was not yet ready to become herself again.
During the war, they didn't talk about Jews. Jews were monsters outside, but now suddenly they remembered Jews, and they were afraid the Jews will come and revenge what was done to them. And then I was afraid. When I say I'm a Jew, they think I come for revenge. So, at first, I didn't say it.
2 months after the Russian victory, Edith gathered the strength to reclaim her old identity. She returned to the registrar's office and confronted the very same bureaucrat who had questioned her Aryan bloodline before she was married.
I came to the same man. You know, the civil servants, they stay to the same man. And he said, this is a crime, what I did. I said, yes, it was a crime. And I said, but I don't think you will find an attorney to accuse me.
In post-war Germany, Edith was both a survivor and a citizen. A Jew who had escaped death. But at what price? She knew what role she had to play as Greta Denner. But now, who was Edith Hahn? Where was her family? Edith went to Berlin, to a transit camp for Jewish survivors, hoping to find news of her mother.
I wanted to be in company of Jews at Rosh Hashanah. In Berlin, there was a kind of camp for the people who came through. There were only beds in a big room. People came from different places to Berlin, and like me, was looking for somebody
But the people in the camp were not like her. The men grabbed at her, angry that she had survived somehow intact, outraged at her betrayal of who she was. There was no place for her here.
For the first time, I experienced the awful irrational guilt that besets all survivors. For the first time, it occurred to me that maybe my life as a U-boat did not weigh heavily on the scales of suffering. That the hideous experiences which had transformed the men in the transit camp might make it impossible for them to ever accept me as one of their own.
Should I be sorry that I'm not in among the dead ones? The Nazis should be ashamed, not me.
If you fight for your life, everything is excusable. I mean, if it's just a question of saying I'm not a Jew, and that saves your life, I mean, in what times do we live if you have to say I'm not a Jew? Yes? That is a real problem. Not that she says it, but that we live in the times that she has to say it. You see?
Armed with her new identity card, Edith started over from where she left off in 1938, 7 years earlier, when she was banned from law school because she was a Jew. The Russians controlled the court administration in Brandenburg, now in the Soviet sector of a partitioned Germany. They were desperate to find lawyers with no past allegiances to the Nazi Party. Using the school records that Pepe had saved for her, Edith was appointed to the family court as a judge. This had been her dream from the time she was a young girl.
I was very happy to be a judge, and I was very happy to have ended in my profession what I like. I had always a feeling that what I do is right. What I do is right.
Edith and her daughter, Angela, moved to a building in Brandenburg's nicest district. The former tenant, a Nazi lawyer, had fled the city. There was still an unanswered question in Edith Vedder's new life, Werner. She received only one letter from the prison camp. He wrote, "I hope that fate will give my dearest Greta a strong heart to endure this time of separation." She understood his longing. She had felt it herself in the fields of Osterberg so long ago. Edith begged the Russians for her husband's release from prison, but she heard nothing. 2 years after his capture, there was a knock at the door.
He came in June 47. He came back from Russia. I was hoping that we will go and live together as a happy couple like before. I didn't think of a change. I didn't think of any difference. Even I tell you, when he came home, I hoped I will have another child when he came home.
It is something I cannot understand. I think it was wishful thinking, except that she wanted it. She wanted a happy marriage. It was utopia. It wasn't reality. The fact that she had me baptized shows that she, somewhere in her mind, she knew it wasn't reality.
In early 1947, anticipating Werner's return, Edith had decided to baptize Angela. She believed Werner would be more accepting of their daughter this way.
I had her baptized because I was afraid of the difficulties when he comes back and has a Jewish daughter. I just want to make our life possible together.
But Werner still believed in the Nazi ideology that Jewish blood somehow tainted his little girl. Edith felt lost, ashamed of her decision to baptize Angela, but not yet ready to let go of her husband. And Werner was not ready to let go of the wife he once knew.
He wondered me as I was before. I was very compliant, and now I had to work in the evening. I had to prepare for court cases, and he wanted me to be great again.
I am the same woman, I pleaded. Oh, God, please, darling, try to understand. No, you are not. My wife Greta was obedient. She cooked, she cleaned. She treated me like a king, and I want her back. Everything I had so long repressed, my true instincts, my real personality, all my grief and my bottomless rage roared to the surface. Well, you can't have her, I shouted. Greta is dead. She was a Nazi invention, a lie, just like the propaganda on the radio. And now that the Nazis are gone, she is gone too. I am Edith. I am Edith. I am who I am.
As the position near me was not satisfying for him anymore. And so he wanted a divorce, and he asked for it.
So it was something you wanted too, also?
No, I didn't want it. I didn't want it. But it was a fact he wanted it. My marriage was good. He said to my daughter once that the 2 years he lived with me were the nicest in his life.
Did you love him?
I suppose I did.
You're not sure?
No, it is it's difficult to say. At that time, I'm sure I loved him.
Would you have married him as Edith, Han?
No, I don't think so.
My mother says that she did love him. Now, I'm not in a position to argue with that. But she also says, it was when I asked her about comparing the love that she had with Werner and Pepe. Oh, never the same as with Pepe. I mean, this was obvious to her. It was a totally different person. They were diametrically opposed. But it was safe. It was a little bit of safety. She really felt that this man loved her and would look after her.
Edith had lived out the war years holding on to the precious hope that when Nazi Germany was defeated, somehow her life could be returned to her intact. That dream had failed her. In 1948, Edith sought out what was left of her family, fleeing Soviet-controlled Brandenburg for London, where her sister now lived.
In my sister's eyes, I confronted the agonizing truth. Our mother, Clotilde Hahn, had been murdered after being deported to the Minsk ghetto in the summer of 1942. Was it not Mama who spoke to me through that cold marble statue and directed me to safety? My angel, my beacon, she was gone forever. And my little daughter and I, because of random good luck and the interventions of a few decent people, had been saved.
It was impossible for Edith to talk about what she had lived through during the war and how she had managed to survive. Raising her daughter, Edith never told Angela the truth about her father's Nazi past, nor the fate of all her relatives who never escaped Austria. Over 24 family members had been murdered during the war.
I did get birthday cards from my family. Because at every birthday, my mother wrote 6 birthday cards and signed them from these dead people. And she didn't post them. She put stamps on them, but just in the letterbox on my birthday. And of course, I didn't question it.
And I want her to she grows up like in family. I did want her to grow up as an ordinary member of society, not as an outsider who has suffered or something, and I didn't want her to carry the burden of the Nazi time. I didn't tell her at all.
But I always knew, even from a very young age, that there was something there that one didn't ask about. There was too much pain. When I was about 30, I suddenly came upon my birth certificate. This birth certificate carried not my mother's name as my mother, but Christa Denner's name as my mother. And it had a big swastika on it, a swastika stamp on it. Now, I always knew that I was born in 1944, and I was born in Germany, but the connection to swastikas and Nazism I had never made. And I can definitely remember the shock. My mother should have told me. No doubt about it. My life has been blighted by the Holocaust by not having been told.
There were parts of Edith's life that would have been lost forever were it not for one courageous act by Pepe Rosenfeld. "Destroy my letters," Edith had written to Pepe from the slave labor camp in Osterberg. "Read them and put them in your heart and then burn them." But Pepe, at great risk to himself during the war, had saved Edith's letters, every last one. In 1977, he gave them back to her just before he died, a time capsule of their broken love affair and of Edith's will to survive.
And then he gave it to me, and I took them to Israel. And in Israel, it came to my conscience that I am not immortal. And I was living on my own here. And when she was here, I gave the letters to her.
Angela read the letters and began to piece together the missing years of her mother's life. There were no secrets anymore between the two of them. For Edith, however, the paralyzing fear of somehow being found out still haunted her.
It was a life of constant terror. And it all came flooding back. And she has spent her life, which is why she didn't talk about it, I think, she spent her life trying not to feel that terror. And she has been tested. I have always been conscious of the fact that I have never been tested. How would I have reacted? How would I have chosen to live? What decisions would I have made?
When you ask what it was like during the war, concealing my identity, living with Werner, always fearing exposure. You must forgive me when you hear this small voice. You must remind me. Edith, speak up, tell the story. It has been more than half a century. I suppose it is time.
It's a wonder. It's a wonder. I had so much luck and so much help. It's a wonder. I was born in 1914, at the beginning of the century, and have gone through all the troubles of the century. I have gone through the Jewish troubles, to all the Jewish troubles. and I've lived amongst the Nazis. I've seen good everywhere. Yes. And I have survived only because people were decent to me. Nazis even. I learned much about people, about reactions of people. The human nature is not fixed. But I'm not a scientist, and I can only say and tell what I personally have gone through.